Hello and welcome. Let's talk about two very important principles in SwiftUI, data flow and view composition. Let's start with views. So what is a view? A view defines a piece of UI. They're kind of like the basic building blocks. And just like Lego, you want to build a bigger view out of smaller single-purpose views. This makes it easier to understand and easier to maintain over time as well. So let's use an example to illustrate. Let's say you have a view that represents a color picker and it looks something like this. And because you know that it's a best practice to break down a view into reusable parts, you decide to create a smaller view that represents the slider. Now you can reuse that slider view 3 times in your color picker view. Pretty easy to understand, right? It's all about reuse. Let's talk about data flow now. Now, if you came from working with UIKit, you might have noticed that we don't have a view controller anymore. To understand why there's no view controller in SwiftUI, let's take a look at what the view controller was used for. With UIKit, the view controller managed the data flow between your model and your view. It was responsible for updating your UI whenever the data in your model changed. For example, let's say you have a contacts app, and once the data model finishes loading the contacts, the view controller takes the data and manipulates the UI to show the data. Conversely, the view controller was also responsible for handling user interaction in the view and changing the data based on those interactions. Using the same example, let's say that the user deletes a contact from the UI, then the view controller would have to let the data model know to remove that contact. This is the way we've been used to doing things, but there's a lot of code that you have to write in order to make all of this happen. So in SwiftUI, things are a lot easier for us. The view controller is removed, and instead of having to write all this code to manage the data flow, instead we bind the data in our model directly to our UI. We don't have to write any code to do this, and this way, whenever the data in the model changes, the UI will notice and update itself accordingly. This diagram from WWDC shows clearly how the data flow in SwiftUI works. Now let's say the user makes a change from the UI, for example, deletes a contact. Because your view is written in code, you can have code in your view that handles that user interaction and goes to update the data in your model to remove that contact. The UI will notice that the data has changed and will update itself automatically. So this loop eliminates a lot of the coding that we had to do previously inside the view controller. The next question is, how does SwiftUI achieve this sort of data flow that we see in this diagram without a view controller? Well, SwiftUI has several different ways. For now, I want to talk about state and binding and when you should use each of them. You've already seen what a state property is in previous lessons. You can bind the state property to a piece of UI and have the UI update itself automatically as the data in that state property changes. But how does this work if we try to break up the view as a composition of smaller views? After all, that's one of the guiding principles we talked about in the first part of this lesson. So let's use our color picker example from earlier. Let me quickly point out what data these views need in order to display the UI. The color picker has the color square, and in order for us to display that, we need to know the different amounts of red, blue, and green. However, each of our 3 slider views also needs to know the amount of red, blue, and green respectively. Now let's take a look at this view in code form so that we can clearly see where to put the state properties and bindings to make the data power the UI. Since you've only learned about state properties, let's use that for everything. We said the color picker view needs to know the amounts of red, green, and blue, so we'll have state properties there. Then each slider view also needs to know their own amount of red, green, and blue, so we'll have a state property in the slider view. This state property will be bound to the slider element and text label, so if the user uses the slider, it'll update the value in the state property, which results in the text label being updated. There's a problem with this picture though. Since each slider view is tracking its own color value independently, we've essentially duplicated the data, and we're now tracking the value of each color in 2 places. Furthermore, how is the color picker going to know about the data changes in the slider views? Because it has a color square that it needs to update. So this is where bindings really come in handy. We can have a binding that reads and writes to and from a state property, and then we can pass that binding into a subview for them to use. Let me demonstrate. So here I've got the color picker view project, and we're going to
break it down into smaller views, and I'm also going to show you how to use bindings as well. So just to quickly run this for you so you get an idea of how it works, we have three sliders. You can adjust the levels of red, green, and blue. And as you can see from here, there's a V stack, there's a rectangle representing the color square, and then we have three sliders. Also take note that we have three state properties up here representing the amount of red, green, and blue. And the rectangle, his foreground color, is reading from those state properties, red, green, and blue. And so are the sliders. The sliders are bound to red, green, and blue. And that's why adjusting them affects the state property, which affects the foreground color. Now, if we were to follow that first principle we talked about in terms of view composition, looking at these three sliders, they look very similar. They would be a perfect control to abstract into a smaller view, right? So that's exactly what we're going to do right here. Let's stop this, and then we're going to create a new file, and we're going to choose Swift UI View. And I'm just going to call this slider view. So it starts off with a text field, text element. And we're going to go back to content view, and I'm just going to take one of these sliders. I'm going to copy it, and I am going to paste it in there. Now, because this used to be inside a big view stack or V stack, it's no longer inside a V stack. So we have to declare a V stack there, and we'll put the slider and the text element inside. Furthermore, we no longer have this binding, and this label needs to be dynamic as well if we're going to reuse this slider element. So up here, I'm going to declare, first of all, a text property, actually a string property. And I'm going to, I'm not going to initialize it because I want the color picker view to pass in the text to use. So instead, I'm just going to call it label. I'm going to make it a string, and I'm going to leave it uninitialized. And then for the text here, we are going to insert that label property. Now, as for the binding for the value, what we're going to do is use the @binding property wrapper, and we are going to declare it as var, let's call it value, and the type is double. Now, in here, in the slider, I can bind to, I can pass in that binding value, right? And then in here, instead of showing red, we're going to show value as a number. Now, these two are going to get passed in when we create instances of the slider view in the color picker, as you'll soon see. But first, let's fix one thing in here. This is the preview. We can't see anything on the right here because it's missing initialization parameters. So let's go ahead and do that. So that's what we have to pass in. We have to pass in a binding, and we have to pass in a label, which is just the string. Now, since we don't really have a binding to pass in right here, what we can do is we can do binding.constant and just pass that in as a constant value. It's not a real binding per se, but for the purpose of this preview, it works brilliantly. So for the label, I'm just going to call it label. And then let's hit resume here. Let's see if we can preview something. There we go. So there is our label. And it reaches all the way to the edges. We're not going to add padding to this V stack here, because inside the content view, in this bigger V stack, we already have padding, as you can see here on the left and right. So just to make it look prettier in the preview, I'm going to add the padding to the preview. So this doesn't affect the actual app. It's just so that we can see an accurate representation of what that looks like. And now we can go back to the picker view, and instead of having these slider and text elements, we can remove it and replace it with our new specialized view. So there's our slider view, and we have to pass in a binding and a label. So for the binding, that's what we want to pass in, a binding to that state property. So we're going to use the dollar sign red, and the label is just going to be red, right? And then we're going to copy that and replace this slider. And instead, this is going to be dollar sign green, and this is going to be green as well. And then as you can see, it's actually changing it in the preview. This is going to be blue, and this is going to be blue as well. So now let's run our project and just make sure everything is connected and works. So as you can see, there's red, there's green, and there's blue. Now, just like that, you've seen a demonstration of us breaking down a more complex view into smaller reusable views, as we've done here. And you've also seen an example of using bindings. You see, the color picker view that we have here owns the state properties for red, green, and blue. So it's the source of truth. And we are passing in a binding to those state properties into our slider view so that the slider view can both read and write to the state properties up here.
As you can see, a binding provides two-way communication. The slider view can read the value of the state property in the color picker view, and it can also manipulate the value of that state property through the binding. But a key difference is that the color picker owns the data because the state property is declared in the color picker view. We're no longer keeping two copies of the same data. The color picker view is the source of truth when it comes to the values of red, blue, and green. And you'll hear this term a lot in SwiftUI, source of truth. It refers to who owns the data because you want to avoid two views, both having state properties representing the same data. Instead, you should think about who should actually own the data, aka the source of truth, and have the other views use bindings instead. In the next lesson, we're going to apply these principles to our slots app. All right, I'll see you there.